WXFL videotape sports presentation. The Awakening, Bucs 87.
Tampa Bay Buccaneers will be a most successful team. We're counting on your continued support as fans for the Tampa Bay Buccaneers.
May I say that we're here for one reason and one reason only. That's to bring the fans great professional football.
I always remember December the 11th. It was a Super Bowl for me.
It's obvious that there are a lot of people in Tampa that have been going through the same agony that the Tampa Bay Buccaneers have been going through.
Game of 1977 is a home game. The Bucs would like to win this one. An unbelievable scene here at Tampa Stadium. Fans all over the goalposts tearing them down. The Bucs have done it. They've won their first at-home game at Tampa Stadium. Now they have won two straight.
19-yard field goal attempt. Neil O'Donoghue awaiting the snap from Steve Wilson. It is a low snap. The kick is up. Good! The players are really whooping it up on the sidelines. This is quite a sight to see. A bunch of kids down there. They deserve it.
Just 4 years after their birth in the NFL, welcome to the playoffs. The Tampa Bay Buccaneers against the Philadelphia Eagles in a game that has been dubbed everything from the impossible dream to the Respect Bowl.
Third down and 10 from the 32. Hipple back to pass. Deep drop, Leroy Selman after him. Leroy's got him. The ball's up in the air. It's a fumble. David Logan will take it in. And it's a touchdown, Buccaneers.
Great play, Leroy Selman. Just absolutely reached over the top. Over to the right.
And John McKay will leave the field a winner. His last game as head coach of the Buccaneers.
We're going to get better, and we did. So I was able to go out. I still walk a little shorter than I normally am, but eventually we'll walk tall around here.
I think we have a nucleus here of a very fine football team. I'm sure Mr. Culverhouse has expressed to you on numerous occasions that he has one goal. We all have one goal, and that's to win the Super Bowl as quickly as we can possibly win it.
I proved all of you wrong, and now all of you are sitting here saying, this guy, he's done just the opposite. I'm going to always do the opposite.
It's really a great feeling for me to be back in the National Football League and to accept this, what I know will be a great challenge. Yeah, but I mean, I'm not going to come in like a Marine sergeant, you know. But we're going to have discipline. We're going to run a disciplined team.
Vinny Testaverde becomes the first Heisman Trophy award-winning player out of college to ever be signed in the history of the Tampa Bay Buccaneers.
Everyone, I'm Dick Crippen. Those were some historic moments in the short history of this franchise known as the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Some memorable moments. Matter of fact, my co-host David Sharp had an opportunity to be a part of one of those very special moments. David, you had no idea at that point you'd end up working in this market.
No, you never really know, but back in 1977, I got to take in the St. Louis game when I was here on vacation and saw the spirit and enthusiasm of this community really come together.
Well, that's really what it's about. The Bucs of 1987 are now setting out on a task. Their task? To recapture that spirit from back then. So, how do you remember the first big moment in Buck history, that lightning in Louisiana? You might best remember Richard Wood's Kareem Abdul-Jabbar imitation after his interception.
Did I dunk it over the crossbar?
Yeah, that's what I did, and I think
it was just one of those greatest feelings where I said, well, I have to do something unusual. Since I can't fly and everybody calls me the Batman, I think I just might as well go dunk it over the crossbar and just make everybody in New Orleans say, hey, those guys really deserve to win.
And if you're Leroy Selman, you reminisce about the great outpouring of affection the Bay Area fans gave their conquering heroes when they returned home from that historic moment on the bayou.
Well, I think that was the Super Bowl. You know, I just appreciate so much the fans, the reception that we received after the first victory in New Orleans, coming back to Tampa, where there was 10,000 people there waiting to greet us, and we felt like we had won the Super Bowl.
That wasn't a Super Bowl, but it may have conjured up visions of future glory. Theo Bell knew what it was like to take it all when he was a Steeler. Even though he never scaled those heights in Tampa Bay, he's hoping to see it happen one day with the new Buccaneers.
It usually starts with the players. You know, if you have players that are young and that are enthusiastic about the program, and the Bucs have that right now. They have a lot of young players that are enthusiastic, and they have an opportunity to work together and be together over a period of time, and I look for them to be very successful.
But success can only come with a deep commitment, and that starts at the top. Owner Hugh Culverhouse didn't see a total effort the past two seasons and made the painful but necessary coaching change.
I thought it was time to have a change in coaches. I like Lehman Bennett as a person very much, and he did a lot. I mean, he took the risk of going with the young team. But it was an ideal situation for a change, and Ray Perkins was ready, and I was impressed. He's my Vince Lombardi.
Tough standards to live up to, but Ray Perkins is no stranger to toiling in the shadows of a legend. We'll show you Perkins' path from Tuscaloosa to Tampa Bay when the Awakening Bucs 87 continues.
From what I hear, Perkins is, you know, doing a good job, and they're not going to play Vinny right until he's ready. So that's important things. Let him work himself in. But I think they can win 6-8 games this year.
Visitors to Tampa Stadium this year will notice one big visible change. The home team is back on the east sideline. Coach Perkins wanted to do that to get closer to the adjacent locker room and also to have better exposure from the national TV cameras once his team gets back on national television. Of course, to do that, they need to start winning more, and nobody wants to win any more than Ray Perkins.
When Hugh Culverhouse made what he later called one of his toughest decisions ever to fire Lehman Bennett, it was out of a sense of frustration more than anything else.
I couldn't take another 2 or 3 years of what we'd been through. And I felt very much obligated to the community and to this, the fine fans, do everything possible. Whatever it costs, let's get on with the show and let's get back to winning.
And the man he went after with a vengeance to make this team a winner was Ray Perkins. Word quickly spread of the meeting in Birmingham, and quicker than you can say roll tide, Ray Perkins had resigned his job as head coach at the University of Alabama to re-enter the professional ranks, where Perkins has battled before. He spent 4 seasons in the Big Apple with somewhat modest results in the win-loss column. But many pro insiders give Perkins much of the credit for laying the groundwork with the Giants for last year's Super Bowl championship team. But the question remains, why did Perkins want to try it again? And with a team that's won only 4 games in the last 2 years? For one thing, it's the challenge, something Perkins thrives on. For another, the timing was right to leave Alabama, a place where Perkins was never totally comfortable with all of the recruiting and alumni pressures.
The demands on my time when I was at Alabama, and it's probably not a good excuse, and I'm not trying to use it as an excuse, but the demands on my time were so great, so much greater than any head coaching job in the professional ranks.
At Alabama, he was real tight. Since he's moved here, he's loosened up a lot. I've seen him here more in 4 months than I've seen him 4 years at Alabama. So he's a different person here.
But one thing hasn't changed, even from his days as a player under Don Shula, who now serves as one of Perkins' peers and one of his biggest fans.
Ray Perkins, as a player, was a guy that was very, very intense, very determined, and you could see that the thing that made him a good football player was the same qualities that are making him an excellent coach, because he's very determined as a coach, he's very intense as a coach, he's willing to work morning, noon, and night to be ready to do the best job that he can as a coach, the same thing that he did for me as a player.
I think people have somewhat of one-track mind or tunnel vision, as I call it. I know I have. I've had all my life. Football has been my life.
You might call this a honeymoon period for Perkins. The Bucs still have not lost a regular season game. The spirit is reborn and enthusiasm high. Still in all, Perkins the realist knows much work remains to get this team back to respectability.
We're not halfway there yet. You know, we've just scratched the surface. We've still got tons and tons of work to do to be a football team and be the kind of team that we're going to be one day.
And to that end, the new Buck Admiral has brought in a fresh batch of shipmates, led by the million-dollar arm that may soon take the helm to steer the Bucs out of murky waters of the past.
David, the whole reawakening of the Buccaneers started with this guy right out here, number 14, Vinny Testaverde. His attitude. Remember last year when the first-round draft choice for the Buccaneers said he didn't want anything to do with Tampa Bay? Well, Vinny Testaverde said right from the start he wanted to be a Buccaneer. He is a Buccaneer, and so far it's been nothing but smooth sailing.
From the very first time that Vinny Testaverde held up his new Buccaneer jersey, it looked like a perfect fit. The quickly negotiated contract signing set the tone for what has been an easy transition from his Heisman Trophy winning season at the University of Miami.
I don't think it could have gotten better than this right here, you know, getting to stay in the state of Florida.
When you start talking about all of Vinny's accomplishments in college, you quickly run out of glowing adjectives. But just when did Vinny himself first know that he was as good as everybody else thought he was?
Two games after the Oklahoma game, when everybody was talking great about me and everything was going so smooth, and I felt really good, really confident. And I think that's when I realized that I had a bright future ahead of me.
Bright indeed. The spotlight has been on Vinny T, and the future should only bring more stardom.
He understands the game. He's a great competitor, and he's had some pretty good schooling. Not only the schooling that he had at the University of Miami, but also the schooling that he's receiving with Coach Ray Perkins. I'm sure they'll do a great job with him, and I'm sure he'll be a great pro.
So far, Vinny has been listening and learning a lot about the pro game. A guy who knows a lot about working with young apprentices in the game sees Testaverde as an absolute natural.
What separates him from most quarterbacks is his strength, his physical strength. And he's the strongest quarterback that I've ever seen. And, you know, that helps him. And he has a good football background. He was taught well in college, and he's had a tremendous amount of success. His height also helps him, and he's a good runner, and you go on and on.
You can also say that Vinny's a man with strong family ties. His parents often make the long trip from New York to Florida to watch him play. And as far as a special lady in his life, sorry to break the news to all you single ladies, but Vinny does have a steady girlfriend. Laura Gambucci, who works as a health and fitness instructor, says Vinny has a lot of special qualities.
It sounds corny to other people, but most girls make a list of what they want in a man, you know, or boyfriend. It changes through years, but he's everything. He's real honest. He's got a great sense of humor. He's trustworthy, and he's got a real big heart.
That seems to come through. Whether it's signing autographs for a young fan or signing an endorsement deal with a major corporation, Testaverde's low-key yet confident approach might just make him the right man to guide the Buccaneers ship into the Super Bowl someday.
It's going to be a challenge, don't get me wrong, but things can work out really great for me, for the team, for the all of Tampa Bay.
Although Vinny's the most celebrated rookie on this team, he's certainly not the only one who'll contribute. More on that story when the Awakening Bucs 87 continues.
I'm very happy that the Bucs have Vinny Testaverde and Miami doesn't. I'd like to wish him a great good luck and a great career. And Coach Perkins, good luck on a very successful Tampa Bay football team.
People say you don't act like a rookie. Is that a compliment?
Sort of. You know, just trying to be myself, trying to have as much fun as possible, but, you know, that's what they say. Hey.
They are saying a lot of nice things about Winston Moss and quite a few other first-year Buccaneers. Moss and Ricky Reynolds are both expected to make strong contributions to the defense in 1987. Both possess the quickness and basic football know-how necessary to help rebuild the sagging fortunes of the Buc D. As for the offense, three baby Bucs could see a lot of playing time. Tampa Bay has needed some help at wide receiver, and Mark Carrier thinks he can fill the bill in due time.
I'm pretty, you know, confident in my abilities. Personally, I don't feel I've been playing up, you know,
of my capabilities. I've been playing, I think, about 70-75% of my capabilities. You know, I'm still making silly mistakes. You know, I guess you can say rookie mistakes, but, you know, that's no excuse.
This group of rookies seems to embrace that no excuses theme. It runs deep through their veins. Tight end Ron Hall is a perfect example. Good enough to run off K.D. Dunn and challenge Calvin McGee for the starting job. The first-year man from Hawaii sees the Buc awakening as a long-range success project.
New coach, so he's got to take a look at everybody. I think it's great that they're, you know, going with a young team. Hopefully, you know, we can all be around for a few more years, you know, all together. I think that's the way, you know, you become a winning team is, you know, start young and work together until you, you know, got something there.
There's no question the Bucs have something going in what looks like a bumper crop of new faces, like converted quarterback Don Smith. An absolute jackrabbit at Mississippi State, he's right at home at running back. So much so, it's even surprised Smith himself.
Surprised, yes, you know, but on this level because, you know, it takes a lot of hard work, you know, because you have guys out there just as fast as you are. And they've been around for a while, and you have to try to watch the guys that's here, you know, that's playing running back and learn from them, such as James Waller.
Unfortunately, Smith will miss the first few weeks of the season with a hairline stress leg fracture. His return could go a long way toward taking some of the pressure off of the overworked James Wilder.
Now, a lot of people say the best place to watch a football game is right here, down in the trenches on the sidelines. But there are other people who like the bird's eye view up in the press box. Crip, I see you've moved up there now and have found a place of your own.
Well, David, there are some advantages to this bird's eye view, especially when we start talking the coaching staff and the X's and O's. As a matter of fact, speaking of that, let's talk a little bit about how the Bucs may line up when they start the regular season next weekend.
Critics might justifiably argue that any change would be for the better. On offense, the Bucs will go back to the more traditional two running back formation, where the backbone of this team remains the same. The veteran James Wilder lines up in the fullback spot, and he's the one guy that Ray Perkins has been sure of from the start.
He's a great player. He's a steady player. He's a player that you can count on and depend on throughout the course of the game, and that's the kind of players that we'd like to surround ourselves with.
The quarterback battle may well rage all season, but Steve DeBerg is still the starter, at least until he falters, although he'll undoubtedly share playing time with Testaverde. Their main target still remains the steady, although unspectacular, Gerald Carter. He's supplemented by the work of Phil Freeman, Mark Carrier, and others. But somebody's got to block for all these guys, and the often maligned offensive line of Ron Heller and company will have to get in playing shape quickly to anchor what could be an explosive offense. Defensively, there's no place to go but up, and if opposing offenses go up top against Tampa Bay, the quickness of guys like cornerback Vito McKeever will be tested. He hopes to improve and rely on the help of the new Bucs safety, Bobby Kemp. Linebackers may be the deepest position on the entire team. Guys like Chris Washington have responded to the challenge there and seem to like the aggressive philosophy of new defensive coordinator Doug Graber.
We definitely are looking to establish an extremely physical and aggressive defense, without question. We've never hit that at all.
But so much depends on your defensive line. Kevin Kellen hopes his good preseason showing has won himself a starting job. And with David Logan gone, a leader has to emerge somewhere in the trenches. This could be the year that Ron Holmes lives up to high expectations. Coming up on The Awakening, Bucs 87 will show you some of the high moments of training camp and the preseason. The curtain is about to rise on the new fall campaign.
Hi, I'm Rodney Marsh of the Tampa Bay Rowdies. You know, I get a kick out of soccer, but I think this year with Coach Perkins and the new Buccaneers, we're going to get a kick out of the Buccaneers as well.
Welcome back to The Awakening, Bucs 1987. If you're wondering about the name, well, that's kind of the way we see it at this point in their history. A resurgence, an awakening, if you will. This 1987 season has me excited, and David, it looks like you're pretty excited about it, too.
Yeah, Griff, I can kind of feel the spirit of this whole thing. How about you? You excited?
All right, go back!
I think that kind of qualifies as exciting.
Hey,
I was pretty good with that, you know.
All right, David. I think we can all appreciate that kind of enthusiasm. And that's going to just about do it for this preseason look at the Bucs of 1987. But before we leave, photographer Dave Cook has put together a musical look at the Buccaneers through preseason, getting to this point where they can look ahead to their future now as all of us are looking with them. Thanks a lot for joining us.
Hot town, summer in the city, back of my neck.
People looking half dead, walking on the sidewalk harder than a match.
Yeah, we're definitely in great shape, and it would be tough for other teams to be as equal shape as we are. So, you know, that can be an advantage.
Stop their ass. Knock them down. Knock them down. Make them hurt. Let's go. Stay on them like glue. Kick some ass. Let's go.
Deep drop. Here's Vinny going along, going all the way. Bankston out there. He's got it. Touchdown, Buccaneers. Bobby Bankston.
Here's to the heroes, those who move mountains. Here's to the miracle they make us see.
Handbell, pressure, 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 he's sacked! The Buccaneers will win their first preseason.
Here's to all brothers.